Let's start my talk. This is last talk, PG de Azure. So I'm very upset and nervous. Okay. Who am I? I'm Masanori Oyama. Please call me Masanori or Masa. I'm a database engineer, especially PostgreSQL, and I often answer to customers' questions and provide some advice. Recently, I focus to database security. And I provide new feature and the performance of PostgreSQL new release. And now, my interest is parallel query. It is a big feature of PostgreSQL 9.6. My teammate Masahiko Sawada talked about new feature of PostgreSQL 9.6 and introduced a verification of parallel query in pgconf Azure that is held in last year. This presentation. I also did this verification with Sawada together. So if you're interested, please check this presentation. Okay. At previous talk, I was Hadoop engineer at NTT Data Inc. I managed big Hadoop cluster, which consists 1,000 nodes and has 200 petabyte data in the cluster. I am sometimes surprised by difference of PostgreSQL Hadoop. I think PostgreSQL is more precision software than Hadoop. It catches my interest. Okay, about NTT. I am a member of NTT, Nippon Telegraph and Telephone Corporation. NTT is the biggest telecom company in Japan. NTT OS Center is offering total support service, such as a support desk, introduction, and maintenance of OSS products to these group companies. We also developing OSS products and related tools. We deal with roughly 60 OSS products. Okay, this is today's agenda. First, I will talk about the introduction of today's presentation. Then I will talk about these two sections, database security requirements and how to apply to PostgreSQL. In the first section, I pick out the requirements of related to database from PCI DSS. In the second section, I try to apply these requirements to PostgreSQL. And I talk about PostgreSQL auditing tool developed by us. Okay, let's talk about the introduction. Let me talk about the circumstance in Japan. Japanese government aim to implement an action plan for strengthening the security of credit card transactions by 2020. For example, make business operators holding such information conform to the PCI DSS, and multi-layered measures are introduced by retailers dealing with each transactions. So some of our customers which use PostgreSQL have a credit card information. Sometimes we are asked how to conform to PCI DSS by them. Do you know PCI DSS? PCI DSS is character letter of payment card industry data security standard. So it is one of the famous security standard in the world. It is promoted by these major credit card companies. This is outline of PCI DSS. PCI DSS consists of these 12 sections. Each section has some detailed requirements. Then these rules instruct you how to build and operate credit card system. PCI DSS is the requirement of whole system and operations. So if we want to conform your database to PCI DSS, you have to think about how to apply these requirements to it. Okay, there's one caution. I'm not a security expert or a PCI DSS expert. So the explaining of this presentation is not necessarily correct. If you have to confirm your system to PCI DSS, please consult a PCI DSS expert called QSA. Okay, let's talk about database security requirements. I picked out these four categories from PCI DSS requirements. Keep your database secure, data encryption and key management, user identification, authentication, authorization, identity management, audit. First, keep your database secure. PCI DSS requirements 2 and 6 says, don't use a default user account and password. Don't use unnecessary modules, functions, protocols. Admin control access has to be encrypted. Use latest software version. Okay, there is a not difficult, traditional or basic security practice important. Okay, next, data encryption and key management. PCI DSS requirement 3 says PAN, primary account number, must be unreadable or encrypted. PAN is typically called credit card number, this one. The card number must be irreversibly unreadable or must be reversibly encrypted with enough strong encryption. A method of unreadable is one-way hash or truncation. If you want to encrypt the card number, you must use strong encryption with key management process. PCI DSS say the encryption considered enough strong is AES or RSA, etc. So this requirement is frequently updated. So you should check the PCI DSS glossary and look for the section of strong cryptography. PCI DSS also says encryption key management. The card number must be encrypted by data encrypting key. Then data encrypting key must be encrypted by key encrypting key. So this is called a two-tier encryption. These keys are replaced in a certain period and must be stored separately. And of course, the access of key must be restricted and must be stored in the first location. And you must audit the status of using these keys. The detail of this is written at requirement 3.5, 3.6. Please see that. Okay, next, user identification, authentication, authorization, identity management. PCI DSS requirement 7 and 8 tell about identification, authorization, authentication, and identity management. Identification. PCI DSS says all users must be identified by unique user ID. It does not allow to share a single user account with several people because each user must take the blame for explaining their actions. Authentication. In addition to assigning a unique ID, all users must be also authenticated by the following method. password, token device, biometrics. PCI DSS also instructs some password policy, require minimum length of at least 7 characters, change password at least once every 90 days, and so on. Please see requirement 8.2. Authorization. All user ID is restricted access to least privilege necessary to perform job responsibilities. Identity management. Identification, authentication, authorization are managed by several policies. There is a user ID of the retired person. Local the user ID, which is made a long password 5 times, etc. For details, please see requirement 8.1. Okay, last, audit. PCI DSS requirement 10 tell about audit. This event must be audited, especially to audit all operations of administrators is important because it prevents an insider crime. However, generally, this is difficult. Audit logs must be output following information. And to audit and protect the audit logs is also important. So you should record who and when access the audit logs and protect it from invalid changes. Okay, we have looked at the requirement that PCI DSS require to database. Next, let's look at how these requirements can be adapted to PostgreSQL from foreign categories. First, keep your database secure. First, don't use Postgres account and change 5432 port. Next, use OpenSSL connection with PSQL. For details, please see this man explaining OpenSSL. And PGHP conf is a configuration file of access control. And update binaries to latest minor versions. So, I say again, traditional or bash security practices are important. Okay, next, data encryption and key management. PostgreSQL has encryption module called pgcrypto. pgcrypto is a good encryption module. Today, I don't talk about pgcrypto deeply. For describe, please see this manual. However, there is a difficulty to apply PCI DSS to PostgreSQL. If you want to conform to PCI DSS, you have to manage two-tier key encryption. So by yourself. So this makes application development hard. If you think that this problem is critical, please consult the process vendors. So it seems to me that PostgreSQL needs TDE, transparent data encryption, and KMS, key management service. Today, I don't talk about describe of TDE and KMS, but I think we should start discussion that how to realize TDE and KMS in PostgreSQL committees. Okay.
Can you go on your slide? This thing, KMS. Can I ask question now?
Yeah, sure. Between yours and speaker's understanding.
Yeah. Yeah, that's why I was just taking permission. All right, you mentioned key management services, right? This is something already offered as a hardware security module, right? One of the systems commonly in financial domain. So I don't think so. Oracle has this thing, right? They have TDE, but they don't have KMS, right? So I would like to hear about TDE as we go along, but for KMS, I have this point, I just want to raise it. And frankly speaking, nobody would like to use database KMS, right? They normally go for a hardware, and that hardware is produced normally by tails or safe network, something like that. So just one point.
Okay. Yes, TDE with KMS.
Yeah.
Okay, user identification. User identification and authentication, authorization, and identity management. These are the following important things. Don't use Superuser. Apply PCI DSS password policy. Manage each user ID. For details and next slides. First, don't use Superuser. Superuser can do everything. For example, create user, create table, and change, privilege, etc. So, but this is not allowed by PCI DSS because all user ID must be restricted to least privilege necessary to perform job responsibilities. So regarding how to restrict authority, please see these manuals. However, some useful SQL and functions need to supervise the privilege. For example, create alter event trigger, create holding data wrapper, create table space, these useful functions. We have no choice but to use Superuser. So I think Superuser must be audited fully. Next, password policy. PCI DSS requires some password policy. You can use password check module in PostgreSQL and set the expiration date. Please see the manuals. However, these password policies cannot be implemented in PostgreSQL. Sorry, small character. 8.2.5 do not allow a new password that is the same as any of the least four passwords used. 8.2.6, set password for first time use, and change immediately after the first use. So I think we need to use a directory service in that case. Next, manage each user ID. Delete or lockout user ID according to PCI DSS requirements. Use drop role to delete user ID. And use alter role with no login to lockout user ID. However, to perform the following requirement is hard only in PostgreSQL. Lockout inactive user ID within 90 days, and require the user, and lock out the user who repeated access attempt after not more than 6 attempts, and require the user to re-authenticate if a session has been idle more than 50 minutes. So I think we should use objective service too. PostgreSQL can use LDAP authentication. Today, I introduce the following directory service, Apache DS and Apache Directory Studio. Apache DS is a directory service software. Apache Directory Studio is GUI console of directory service. I have not used this software in the production service, But I think these are nice identity management too. So Apache DS has rich password policy configuration, rich lockout policy configuration, and can output authentication logs, which is used for log auditing. Apache DS can execute authentication and management user ID of PostgreSQL according to PCI DSS requirements. But there are some attentions. Apache DS cannot create user accounts in PostgreSQL. So you should create a PostgreSQL user account, then register them to the Apache DS. And Apache DS and Apache Directory Studio cannot control the edit authorization of PostgreSQL. So you need to log in to PostgreSQL to edit the authorization of PostgreSQL. Last, audit. We can use PostgreSQL server role for auditing. If you can these parameters, if you set these parameters, PostgreSQL server role output these event required by PCI DSS. The access to audit log should be audited by OS module. For example, audit.d, which is a Linux auditing tool, is good tool for this purpose. If you set logline prefix, server log can output the following information. For description, please see the manuals. But object name or object ID does not outputted by server log. It causes difficulty to audit. I will explain on the next slide. And to protect audit logs, use syslog to send it another server and use audit.d, which is introduced previous slide. PostgreSQL server log has some difficulty to apply PCI DSS to PostgreSQL. First, server log output the SQLs without changes and do not output the information of object name. So, some SQLs are difficult to audit. For example, do statement. Do statement can execute SQL or a procedural language in these dollar-coded literal. So you can execute this SQL world. This is the output of server log. If we want to know about SQL access to important table, it is hard to search. Cannot grab. Next, the log size is big. Because server log does not have useful log filters, so server log output the all tables logs. Next, Superuser can change server log settings easily. So server log is hard to conform to requirement 10.2.2 because server log configuration are added easily by Superuser. Superuser can change these parameters whether a PostgreSQL is running or stopped. So Superuser can make server log setting to audit ineffective without anyone noticing. Next, cannot divide a log. Oh. Okay. Next, cannot divide the log for auditing into a log for operating. Typically, audit logs contain the confidential information because they are the same as contents in the database. So only users who have a job-related need can read audit log files, for example, auditors. But server logs are important to operation of PostgreSQL. Database operators often read that files. So to output log to audit with server log is undesirable. Okay, so we should use pgaudit instead of server log for auditing. Pgaudit is developed by Second Quadrant and Crunchy Data. This is log and URL. You can use it easily by installing and setting parameters, setting pgaudit to shared preload libraries in PostgreSQL.conf. Pgaudit can reduce audit log size. Set class name to audit pgaudit log parameter in PostgreSQL.conf. If you set pgaudit to read, only these SQL select values are outputted. If you set write, only these set SQL outputted, insert, update, delete. For example, if you set pgaudit logs to write, DDL, and MISC, then execute these SQLs begin select update commit. So this is output of the log. Select it does not output it. And the log size is suppressed to the minimum you need it. Pgaudit can output object name related to SQL. If you set pgaudit log to read, then execute this SQL that is explained previous, pgaudit output these logs. Table name is outputted with schema name. So to search SQL, accessing to important table is easy. Okay. I think you can understand pgaudit is good tool for auditing. However, it cannot cover the two PCI DSS requirements yet. First, a superuser can change pgaudit setting easily. Just like server log settings, pgaudit configuration edited easily by superuser because pgaudit configuration is in PostgreSQL.conf. Next, cannot divide a server log into a pgaudit log. Pgaudit log output with server log. Just like server log, this calls that database operators read the old logs. This is undesirable. So I think that a supervisor must not be able to change audit setting easily and divide a server log into a pgaudit log. Okay, so we forked the pgaudit and add some new features. Entity audit center pgaudit. Today called entity pgaudit. Entity pgaudit enhancement point this. Restarting PostgreSQL is needed to change audit setting. Entity pgaudit config file is divided from PostgreSQL.conf. So superuser have to restart PostgreSQL to change entity pgaudit configuration. That is not easy in the production environment. So superuser cannot change entity pgaudit configuration easily. Divide a server log into an audit log. Pgaudit can send a log log management server by Cicero, and rich log filter. PGAudit has some useful log filter, so the log size is suppressed to minimum. I will explain these later. I touch entity PGAudit configuration file for next explanations. Entity PGAudit configuration file consists of these sections, output, option, and rule. In output section, you can set logger you use server log or syslog. And option section, you can set some misconfiguration. In rule section, you can set filter rule. For describe, please read the readme. Okay, first, restarting PostgreSQL is needed to change audit settings. Entity PGAudit has only two parameters in PostgreSQL conf. Especially, entity PGAudit raw, entity PGAudit has PGAudit config file parameter, which indicate a PGAudit config file path. Other PGAudit settings are in PGAudit.conf file, because only the auditor had better be able to edit PostgreSQL.conf. Edit pgaudit.conf. For example, the auditor login to auditor user account. This, then edit pgaudit.conf file and change permission. Supervisor, for example, PostgreSQL user, cannot change audit settings. Next, divide a server log into audit logs. Entity PGAudit can export to server log or syslog, this setting in output section. If you send the audit log to a log management server, only auditor can access audit log file. Okay, rich log filter. Entity PGAudit has these filters. This setting in rule section. For example, if you set auto role to supervisor one, only supervisor one's role are outputted. In addition to this, if you set auto role to app user one, and object name to my schema forget table. For example, my schema forget table. So only the SQL accessing by superuser one and the SQLs accessing to my schema forget table by superuser one are outputted. So the log size is suppressed to minimum by entity PGAudit. I explain this example use case. There are PostgreSQL primary server and secondary server. The primary server accepts the access of OLTP application from application user, and secondary server accepts the access of analysis application from BI user. DB operator and DB administrator execute each management task. For OLTP AP, entity PGAudit only output the read and write SQL accessing to important table because to minimum to the log size. For analysis AP, entity PGAudit output all read SQL accessing to all tables. For operating task and administration task, entity PGAudit output all SQL. these logs sent to the audit log management server by syslog. And for example, ThreatD, auditor manage the logs. Auditor manage these entity pgaudit configuration files. Auditor management these entity pgaudit configuration file. And execute audit task by, for example, Elasticsearch. Okay, finally, wrap up. PostgreSQL can conform to PCI DSS by following things. Set basic configuration, use PG crypto, use a dictionary service, use entity pgaudit. And I think PostgreSQL should be better to implement TD and KMS API and to realize operation of PostgreSQL wizard and realize operation of PostgreSQL wizard supervisor privilege. Okay, thank you for listening to my presentation.
KMS is something that should be in the database, right? Or it should be a feature provided by database. Or even when using PG crypto, for example, for encrypting your data, and at the same time you're talking about auditing and logging, don't you think your sensitive information is going to get logged at the very same time? So don't you think it should be rather left to the application to encrypt the data and send the encrypted data back to the database? So instead of making it all database's responsibility, do you think to achieve PCI DSS, it is very important that application also shares some responsibility? Instead of database making encrypting the database, database doing the encryption of sensitive field. For example, if I call a pgcrypto function with my credit card information, and that query is getting logged, or if I have access to pgstat activity, I can see the credit card information. Even though after storing it in the database, it is encrypted, if I have access to the log, or if I have access to pgstat activity, I can still see the credit card information. So don't you think it is more important to encrypt the data in the application and not load or expect too much out of the database itself?
Sorry, I'm not good at English.
Oh, sorry.
Please, finish it.
Okay. Probably, we have a several way of protecting the data. So we can have application level encryption and also database level encryption as well. So, because PCI didn't say that everything have to be done in
service. Do you think KMS is something which should be or which should be expected in the database? Or do you think that is something that has to be, or encrypting sensitive fields particularly, mm-hmm. do you think that has to be offloaded to the database? Or do you think it should be managed in the application? And application sends an encrypted payload to be inserted in a column which stores maybe a large text data. So, mm-hmm. you only store encrypted credit card number and not the and don't call the PG crypto function to encrypt it in the database.
What if the application server logs has that information?
Then they are PCI compliant.
No, then you should be okay. That is
the
now,
same thing. Like
not really. Before doing that particular operation, I can control and I can change the logging level of my application just for that particular operation. And then
can't we do that in the database?
Can't you do that in the database? No, because database has to show all the operations going on. You can't really mask that in a
kind of a masking. I'm not sure about in Postgres, but we can do some kind of masking where the sequence that you write can be masked.
Basically. I have done PCI compliance for many applications and in the past, and I can share some experience. First of all, database
The number one thing is that, of course, you don't have that track information in the combined format available, right? That's called track, right? Your PAN and your expiry, when you combine them together, they become a track. And that should not be stored. This is the problem, right? This is the problem. This is basically the clause, actual clause, what they are complaining, PCI guys. So we put that in database, and okay, then PCI guys came in and they said, no, this is that. And then we kept them separately. And then, if I'm allowed to talk, right, we were using Oracle, and there was a solution name as I, missing the name, some transparent transparent data encryption. Oracle data vault is something which, like, TD is like, is something you guys are talking, you know, you encrypt the whole table. Basically, on application, doing it on application level was very dangerous. In fact, it's a dangerous proposition. We are running an application at 400 TPS in terms of financial transaction. We really cannot afford to do this thing every now and then. So we need a very super fast mechanism. So what they were suggesting is, like, on the application side, normally it gets slower. So rather than, by the way, PCI just relaxes it. It's not like PCI is saying that you cannot store the card. Yes, you have to store the card number, that's PAN, and expiry in separate fields, okay? And if your database is secure with the passwords, nobody is getting in. If somebody is getting in, then he is getting everything, right? By the way, I go forward, right? We are logging the transaction, those financial transactions, they are logged with all the information, right? And that data is getting in there as well. So it's not only the customer data, the transaction data is also in there. I can see that as well. And as far as your servers, so I guess both the things, right? The KMS should be there for if you're going for something like vault, like we said. TD should be there, but I guess something similar to transparent data encryption which Oracle has, right? This is something good, but eventually what we learned over the time, we didn't go for transparent data encryption, frankly, because the clients cannot afford that, right? It was very expensive. So, and PCI relaxes this thing, and you just keep both things separate, and you don't have to print them in the log, as a gentleman was mentioning. So you have to control that, right? And if you, of course, in database logs, as you were mentioning, how does the database know that this SQL is going to contain the track data, right? So it has no way to figure it out, right? So I guess encryption of logs, and by the way, all these PCI guys, and you know, if you're, first of all, the log should not be open at any given point in time, right? And if you are opening it, you are writing a consent or something like that. So one thing I like, right, we should be doing some transparent data encryption if it has to be done, right? But other than that, I think KMS part, I guess that's a very stable or you would say a known standard in the industry that they would use hardware-based solutions for that, because of the load that software really cannot handle. So that's a firmware-based solution. So my two cents are that we should be having something like TD, because that is something missing, I guess. And it's very expensive, by the way. They are selling this feature as telling everyone, yeah, look, you have, initially when we were doing, I remember PCI, we didn't know too much, and we were like, and the banks, your software was running in the banks, and we were having an argument in the bank, right? Oh, your application is so poor, it does not encrypt the data. What should I do? Oh, okay, buy this software. And this software was way too expensive, right? So they really cannot afford to do that. And so it is something, it is very important, I guess. If we don't have it, we should have it.
What about key point?
Yeah.
I want to this.
You want to, yeah, basically
just a very quick question. You mentioned about a modified version of pgaudit that you guys have modified for your internal usage. I was just curious, is it open source yet, or are you planning to submit those back to the original because you found it, right? Do you plan on doing that, or?
So, said entity pgaudit is here on GitHub, so open source code, and we plan to merge original pgaudit, so second account and crunch data.
I'm sorry to be asking this, because I just tried that URL and I was getting a 404 error, so I thought maybe it's a permission issue, because I cannot see that source. Probably I'm missing something here, but that's the context behind the question. That URL does not open for you.
The GitHub, you're saying?
Yeah, the GitHub, yes.
Yes, it's open source.
I wasn't able to open that. But anyways, if it is open source, then
okay.
Yes.
My question to both of you, do you have any plan of making it in code or adding it as an extension which is in the core contrib or core extensions?
Okay, so what happens is because most of these features that are available in as contrib, they are normally, there is some sort of a chat going on somewhere where they are being pitched for the code. It just the issue is that it can normally take a longer period of time for that discussion to be over, because typically all across the globe they keep pitching in with various requirements. I mean, somebody could suggest change this, or somebody could suggest I don't like this, it should be this or that. So that kind of a discussion normally takes, sometimes it goes over years and years. So once that discussion is over, the module gets added to the core distribution. So that is somewhere on in middle. I'm not sure when it will be over, but there are many other such extensions which are still available as open source extensions on GitHub. They're not part of the core distribution.
So it comes very soon.
Yeah, hopefully. And I actually really appreciate the part that you were able to make changes for yourself, because of course it's open source and you were able to do that. And then you are still keeping it as open source so that somebody else can make further changes if needed. And but another good idea would be to create a patch on top of it and submit it to the original repository. So that anybody, because I was not aware of this, right? I only got to know about it today. I wasn't aware of any such feature set or any pending patch anywhere. So one of the ideas could be to go ahead and create a pull request and submit your patch there to the original repository. Of course, the original developers, which is, of course, we have within second quarter, we'll have a discussion around it, and if people like it, it will get merged. And when that extension gets merged with the PostgreSQL core distribution, those pieces will be there. And this will not have to remain a separate fork. I hope I was able to explain.
Yeah. I think because some company in Japan is also interested in the adding meetings. Work together for visual and also we should do some, you know, features in the core.
So personally, yeah. my preferences are is anything that you develop, any feature set, the best way to go forward is to contribute it to the community, to the free and open source version, so that it is available for the general masses, right? And when there are any changes, of course, other people can do that. Promoting your own fork is one way to do it. Keeping it open source is another way to do it. But then, if it is contributed back to the core, that's a general benefit.
Yes, we're thinking the same. But actually, because it's quite, you know, we have a customer quite have a requirement right now. Right. So I don't think we can get this feature in core as, you know, sooner. It takes, you know, several years. So that means we need some, you know, kind of open project or kind of tool project which is not in core. So we take time, you know, like 2-3 years maybe waiting, maintain these tools, and then gradually we put some features in core, and finally we can get at least, you know, like in the contrib module, as a contrib module, or maintain by the core. That's the best way.
Just on that point, a recent example, so you would know about the table sum. That remained as an extension for quite an extended period of time. We've been using that as part of another product, and we were distributing it as part of that particular product. It wasn't part of the core distribution.
Physiological
is another example.
It has moved really faster than a lot of other extensions, and I would love to see a lot of other great extensions move as fast as pgaudit. I can understand that there was a certain demand for pgaudit, and that's why it moved that fast.
It had a push.
Yeah.
So it really makes sense to keep contributing, but then the other aspect is as much important as creating those features in this to contribute to the original product.
Yeah.
But I would really appreciate, and I really appreciate that set part as well, if we actually modified it.
Okay. Thank you.